Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Vinyl Resting Place by Olivia Blacke. Narrated by Nicol Zanzarella. Chapter 1. The best part about working for the family business is that they can't fire me without causing all sorts of unwanted drama. The worst part is, I can't ever quit. Not unless I want to hear about it every single Thanksgiving for the rest of my life. Although, I would put up with a whole lot for a plateful of Uncle Calvin's deep-fried turkey. And as a bonus, at the family record shop, I get to work with my two older sisters. Juni, it's been too long. An older black woman shuffled toward me, arms outstretched for a hug. My full name is Juniper, Juniper Jessup, but most folks around here call me Juni. Miss Edie, I exclaimed, folding myself into the shorter woman's embrace. Growing up in Cedar River, Texas, all the latchkey kids found their way to Miss Edie's after school. Even though my mother was usually home or at the family record shop, at least once a week, I invented an excuse to join the other kids at Edie's. You're looking amazing. Don't you know it? She agreed with a wide grin. She let go and stepped back to clasp my hands. As usual, she was dressed in bright, garish colors, held together with elastic and Velcro. Her curly white hair was cut short, and her grin was genuine. Just look at this place. You and your sisters done good, kid. Thanks, I replied with a blush. I looked around Sip and Spin Records, the record shop slash coffee bar my sisters and I owned, and felt a surge of pride. The back wall behind the barista station and cash register was rough, exposed red brick, lending an air of industrial chic to the crowded store. The side walls were a silvery gray, but I could barely make out the paint underneath a layer of vintage concert posters and framed albums. Above us was a second-floor loft ringed with a wide balcony where shelves full of records were mounted to walls and bins, with even more albums lined up against the shiny black railing. The front wall was enormous panes of glass decorated with our logo on either side of the main entrance, the door to which was currently propped open to welcome customers and friends. It was almost 10:30, and the grand opening of Sip and Spin Records was in full swing. Upbeat music and happy overlapping conversations filled the room. I didn't know why I'd been so nervous that the party would be a bust. We were packed to capacity, with people filling the main floor and the balcony overhead. Although, to be fair, that probably had at least as much to do with the free-flowing beer kegs set up near the coffee station and the complimentary taco truck out front as it did with our advertising campaign or the resurging interest in vinyl records. Then again, there were plenty of people browsing our carefully cultivated collection. Hopefully, that would convert into future sales and repeat customers. I see some folks I need to talk to, but now that you're back in town, you come see me soon, hear? Edie said. I most certainly will, I agreed. I felt bad that I hadn't gone around to see her already, but things had moved at a frantic pace ever since I moved back home. We'd worked constantly to get the shop ready for tonight's opening, so I hadn't had much time to myself. Besides renovating the space and filling it with records, my oldest sister, Tansy, had come up with the idea of setting up a small coffee shop in the back corner, which had wreaked havoc on our permits. But in the end, we got it all done by working together and calling in every favor we'd ever collected. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw my middle sister, Maggie, dash toward a patron who was leaning over the golden oldies section, a glob of guacamole oozing ominously from the end of their taco. She swooped in with a napkin to avert disaster with the skill of someone used to cleaning up other people's, and by other people's, I mean my, messes. Out of the three of us Jessup girls, Maggie was the most fastidious. We shared a bedroom growing up. Her side was neat as a pin. Mine, well, was significantly less so. She had a lot of practice picking up after me. It felt like deja vu, not only being home in Texas and watching Maggie in action, but also being back in this familiar record store. As the baby of the family, I'd felt the need to spread my wings farther than either of my older sisters. I'd left home soon after graduating from college, hook 'em horns, to make my own way in the world. But now, 6 years later, I was right back here in quiet Cedar River, just outside of Austin, the live music capital of the world. And with a lot of hard work and a little luck, maybe we could make Sip and Spin the capital of vinyl records, too. My grandparents used to own a record shop in this very storefront, back in vinyl's original heyday. My mother and her brother, my Uncle Calvin, grew up in this shop. And later, after Mom met our dad, not 6 feet away from where I was standing right now, my sisters and I grew up here, too. By then, we sold cassette tapes and CDs, too, but eventually Napster and iTunes put us out of business. Then, the miracle happened. Millennials discovered vinyl. Between a wave of nostalgia and the desire to experience music without commercials, records were back in a big, big way, and my sisters and I were poised to make the most of it. A man's booming voice cut through the happy party chatter.
"Excuse me, folks, if I can have your attention, please."
I made my way around the checkout counter to turn down the background music playing over the shop sound system. Conversations faded as our guests focused their attention on the makeshift stage we'd erected, where the cafe chairs and tables would go when we opened for real tomorrow. Mom's brother, Calvin Voigt, stood tall and proud as he lifted a red solo cup. It didn't have the same effect as a glass flute, but tonight wasn't about putting on airs. Tonight's grand opening was about celebrating with friends and family, which equated to beer kegs, not champagne bottles.
"Thank y'all for coming out tonight,"
Uncle Calvin said, leaning into the microphone, not that he needed it. He had a booming voice to match his large frame and even bigger personality. A white man in his 60s, he was wearing what I considered Texas formal attire. Dark-pressed denim blue jeans and a long-sleeved green and gray checkered shirt, fastened up to a bolo tie featuring a silver, long-horned cow skull, topped off with a lighter shade of denim jacket. His salt and pepper, more salt than pepper these days, mustache was combed to perfection, and unless I was mistaken, he'd gotten a trim for the occasion. He pushed back the brim of his cowboy hat to survey the crowd.
"This here record shop will forever hold a special place in my heart. As you may or may not know, even though Thomas Edison is credited with inventing the phonograph way back in 1877, the origin of vinyl records can actually be traced to Frenchman Leon Scott in 1857.
The crowd let out a collective groan, knowing that they were about to be treated to one of Calvin's long, rambling stories. We'd begged our uncle to take it down a notch just for one night, but apparently our pleas had fallen on stubborn ears. Then he turned to me and winked.
"But while tonight is historic, I'm not gonna bore y'all with a history lesson. We're here tonight to celebrate the grand opening of Sip and Spin Records."
He paused for a smattering of applause and lifting of solo cups in the assembled crowd.
"So without further ado, I'd like to turn the festivities over to my three beautiful nieces, Tansy, Magnolia, and Juniper Jessup."
"Maggie," the three of us corrected him in unison as we headed for the stage. Even though all the women in our family were named after flowers, Maggie had always resented her name. Anyone who dared call her Magnolia against her wishes had to answer to the Jessup sisters. We took our places on the stage. Uncle Calvin kissed my oldest sister, Tansy, on the forehead as she passed and started to do the same with my middle sister, but she stopped him cold with a fierce glare. If looks could kill, he'd have needed to wear a Kevlar jacket instead of a denim one to escape unscathed from the faux pas of calling her by the wrong name. I gave her a gentle nudge to get her moving again. Her knee-length floral dress, she had a closet full of completely interchangeable ones just like it, swished as she walked. "You might want to lock your doors tonight," I warned my uncle with a smile to show him I was at least half joking.
"Don't you worry yourself. I ain't scared of your sister. Much."
He tossed Tansy the microphone before hurrying off. It probably wasn't necessary. The store was packed, but small, and my oldest sister's voice carried. That hadn't changed since we were kids.
"Hey, y'all,"
she said, waving as if she had just won the Little Miss Texas pageant and had the place of honor in the lead float for the 4th of July parade. Again. She wore a pink pastel twin set over a long denim skirt for the occasion, and her ultra-short brown hair was done in soft waves.
"I can't tell y'all what it means to us for everyone to be here tonight. Uncle Calvin calls it a grand opening, but in truth, it's a grand reopening. Nearly 60 years ago, our grandparents opened a record shop in this very storefront, and it's been such a huge presence in all our lives as long as I can remember. When their record shop closed in 2005, it was the end of an era for Cedar River. Well, I'm here to tell y'all that a new era begins tonight."
Tansy's speech was met with tremendous applause. She continued,
"Seeing it now, restocked and packed with friends and family."
I heard the hitch of emotion as her voice trailed off. Unlike myself, Tansy loved the spotlight. But if I didn't intervene quickly, she would turn on the waterworks. Neither myself nor her mascara wanted that, so I slid past Maggie, wrapped one arm around Tansy's shoulders, and pried the microphone out of her quivering hands. I swallowed down my stage fright, reminding myself that the crowd in front of me was made up of family and friends I've known for a lifetime. Then I cleared my throat and said, "We all hope that Sip and Spin will become the greater Austin area's premier location for discovering new music, finding great local musicians, and exploring the joy vinyl has to offer, all while sipping your favorite caffeinated beverage with friends. Be sure to swing by tomorrow when we officially open for business, when the drink special of the day will be Java Be Good." That had been Maggie's brilliant idea, to combine our love of caffeine with our love of music to create unique specials with memorable names. We sat up many a night coming up with the perfect blend of musical references and coffee drinks that we couldn't wait to serve to our customers. "Thanks again to everybody for coming out tonight," I continued, trying to ignore the way my hands were starting to sweat. I was usually more than happy to let Tansy have the limelight while I worked behind the curtain, but I could get through this. "Enjoy the beer and tacos, and don't forget to tag your pictures with the hashtag #SipAndSpinRecords, all one word, on social media." I switched off the microphone and, instead of replacing it back in the stand, clutched it for dear life. If I left the mic on the stage, we'd eventually be treated to impromptu, drunken karaoke, which was not the vibe we were going for tonight. Although I made a mental note to revisit the idea later. Anything that drew customers into the shop was good for business. "Look at the three of you girls, all grown up and together again," my mother gushed, gathering us all up in a group hug as we exited the stage. Begonia Jessup, known by most as Bee, had an eye-catching blend of dark and light gray hair, with a few strands of silver acting as natural highlights. When I was a kid, it was usually in a long braid, but she'd since cut it to shoulder length, somewhere between Tansy's ultra-short and Maggie's medium haircuts. Only my sister's hair was chestnut brown like mine. Mom's features had sharpened with age, and her skin wasn't as taut as it used to be. But every time I saw her, it was like looking into a mirror from the future. "Just having y'all home is a gift," she went on. Like any family, my sisters and I had our share of spats when we were younger, but a few years and a lot of miles apart had made us appreciate each other in a way that being forced to wear matching outfits in the annual Christmas portrait never had. And Juni, I'm so proud of my baby girl. Speaking in public? I never thought I'd live to see the day. You didn't speak a single word until you were nearly 6 years old, you know. I know, Ma. I'd heard the story enough times. Everyone in Cedar River had. Shucks, I wouldn't be surprised if everyone in Austin had heard it at least once. People assumed that my lack of speaking was because I was shy, which was only partially true. Between Tansy naturally gravitating to the spotlight and Maggie's middle child FOMO, I could never get a word in edgewise. Now y'all get together. I need a picture of this for Facebook. Calvin, get over here. Family picture time. We put our arms around each other and scrunched together in a familiar pose. Mom was in the middle, standing proud. Tansy stood on her right. She was the tallest of the three of us sisters. Her hair barely brushed the top of her long, thin neck. Even though her beauty pageant days were long gone, she still had a sharp jaw and delicate features. Maggie stood on the other side of Mom. Her jovial smile never looked forced and set off the pleasant roundness of her cheeks and deep dimples. Then, on the end, was me. I wasn't as tall as Tansy, but had a few inches on Maggie. My hair was longer than either of my sisters, reaching the middle of my back with barely a hint of wave, even when it was wet. I envied Maggie's armpit-length spiral curls. I tried to replicate it with an at-home perm once, and let's just say it took a long time for my hair to recover. Even with Mom's hair gone gray, we shared the same big brown eyes and heavy, arched brows. There was never a question that we four were closely related, something that bothered my dad to no end. Out of three kids, he would have liked it if even one of us had taken after him. Much to his chagrin and our relief, he didn't get his wish. Although I did inherit his eyesight, and as a result had worn glasses ever since I was little. My sisters used to tease me about them, but these days they were my favorite fashion accessory. I had several pairs, each with colorful frames. Tonight's were a pink and black speckled pattern. Mom thrust her phone at the nearest partygoer. "Make sure you get us all in the picture," she instructed him. "Yes, Miss B," he replied dutifully. He snapped a few pictures and handed her phone back to my mother to inspect them. "Juni," she exclaimed, "what have I told you about giving your sister bunny ears?" I grinned and wiggled my bunny ear fingers. Old habits die hard, I guess. She shook her head, but her smile never faded, so she couldn't have been too upset at my familiar antics. Our family albums were stuffed full of goofy poses and bunny-eared sisters. She posted the picture online before slipping her phone back into her purse. "I wish your daddy was here to see this. He'd be so proud," she smiled wistfully. He'd been gone 2 years now, and he wouldn't have wanted to cast a shadow over an otherwise perfect family moment. So instead of letting myself dwell on what we'd lost, I grabbed a fresh solo cup and filled it halfway. I lifted it in a toast. "To Dad." "Hear, hear," my sisters echoed, clinking our plastic cups together. "Now, as much as I love seeing all my girls together, y'all can't just keep standing around ignoring your guests," Mom said. "It's rude. Go, mingle. You too, Juni," she added as if I was still that little girl who refused to speak. "Sure thing," I replied. Like my sisters, I'd been working tirelessly to get the shop ready for customers. I'd helped organize and advertise our grand reopening and wanted it to be a raging triumph. I was as invested, literally and figuratively, as everyone else in the family with making Sip and Spin Records a success. I'd been saving up for a house I could call my own, but I'd just lost my job when Tansy announced that this storefront was available and suggested that we revive the family record shop. We jumped on the idea, and I contributed all the money I'd earmarked for a down payment without any hesitation. Or rather, without too much hesitation. It wasn't a lot of money in the grand scheme of things, not going to space for funsies money, but it was every penny I had. Both of my sisters chipped in the same exact amount, ensuring we three were equal partners. It wasn't quite enough to get the shop off the ground, but Mom still had a little left over from Dad's life insurance policy, and our Uncle Calvin tossed in the remainder that we needed on the condition that he remain a silent partner. Did we know how to open a family business or what? The record shop was crowded, which was a good thing. Balloons dangled from the high ceiling and clustered under the balcony ledge. Crepe paper streamers decorated the displays. A grand opening banner hung across the back wall. The long, shiny bar near the register that held the complicated espresso machine and a tray full of mugs with the Sip and Spin logo on it was littered with discarded solo cups and crumpled up taco wrappers. An informal line snaked around the shop, ending at a keg of local craft beer that was on its last dregs. Mixed in with the vintage rock and roll posters and framed vinyl records lining the walls were autographed and rare albums encased in glass protectors. Normally, there would be several racks filled with records in the center of the shop, but we'd temporarily relocated them to the stockroom in the back to make room for a crowd. We just weren't expecting quite this many people. It was a good problem to have. The party spilled out of the store and onto the sidewalk out front, where a taco truck was parked at the curb. We'd handed out tickets to the first 100 guests for free tacos. I felt into the pocket of my jeans, where 2 tickets remained. Thank goodness. I'd been too nervous that no one would show up to the big event to eat anything earlier, and now I was ravenous. I made my way through the crowd, stopping briefly every few feet to say howdy and make sure everyone was enjoying themselves. By the time I got to the sidewalk, I was ready to chew off my own arm if I didn't get something to eat soon. Luckily, the line was short, and I queued up at the back of it. Finally, it was my turn. As I pulled the tickets out of my pocket, the man inside the taco truck reached out to slide the window closed. "Hey, wait, I haven't ordered yet," I protested. "Sorry, lady, we're all sold out." "How is that even possible?" I asked. He shrugged. "What can I tell you? People love tacos." The man had a point. He closed and latched the window. A few minutes later, the truck rumbled away. I watched the food truck retreat, my stomach grumbling almost as loud as its muffler. "Juni?" I looked up to see who was calling my name and saw a Hispanic man on the sidewalk heading my way. He was maybe an inch over 6 feet tall, not counting his ostrich cowboy boots, or a well-worn cowboy hat that looked like it had once been brown, but was bleached and weathered by years of exposure to the brutal Texas sun.
"Just look at you. I hoped I'd catch you tonight."
"Teddy!" He went in for a hug. I extended my hand for a shake. We bumped into each other and ended up settling for an awkward half-embrace with my arm trapped between us before we each took a step back. "It's so good to see you." He grinned again and removed his hat. His hair was short on the sides and brushed back on the top, held in place with enough product that it withstood being crushed by his hat, but not so much that it didn't still look soft and manageable. It wasn't fair. Even when we were awkward, scrawny preteens, Teddy always had the best hair. And he wasn't awkward or scrawny anymore.
"Juniper Jessup, back home in Texas at long last. I heard the rumors, but I had to see for myself."
"Teddy Garza, how have you been, my old friend?" I'd known Teddy since about forever. We'd been best friends from grade school until we drifted apart when we went to separate colleges. Despite its nearness to Austin and the metropolis's tendency to gobble up nearby towns, Cedar River was a tight-knit community. Most people lived here all their lives and knew everyone else. Myself, I was third generation. If my sister Maggie ever had children, they would be the fourth.
"Same old, same old," he replied. "Nothing ever changes around here. Not like you, though. Last I heard, you were out in California or something.
Oregon, actually, I corrected him, working for a tech company. We developed digital footprint aggregation software. His eyes glazed over, as most people's did when I tried to explain what I did for a living. Or at least we used to. What happened? He asked. Bankruptcy, layoffs, same old story. That was the short answer. IT changed so rapidly that by the time I excelled at a new skill or programming language, it was already obsolete. My company was on top of the game for a few years, but once it got overtaken, the restructuring began. I was still holding out hope that we'd get gobbled up by another, bigger company when everything crumbled and the owners took off without so much as a backward glance.
Sounds rough. Want to talk about it?
I shrugged. For years, I gave them 10 hours a day, 6 days a week, and they didn't even have the decency to fire me properly. I just showed up on Monday and the doors were locked. To add insult to injury, I worked from home most of the time, but that particular Monday, I'd driven all the way into the office, in rush hour, in a skirt and suit jacket instead of my normal jeans and a t-shirt, because we had a client coming in. Some days, it just didn't pay to shave my legs. I worked at a record shop now, a record shop that I partially owned. It was scary, knowing that my grandparents' record shop had gone out of business, just like my old tech company had. But my sisters and I were determined to make it work. There was a bit of irony buried in there somewhere, and I didn't mean the Alanis Morissette song. Technology forced the original record store to close when physical media was replaced with downloadable MP3s and streaming services. But when my job writing the kind of computer software that made digital music possible went belly up, I found myself right back here in Cedar River at the rebooted record shop. Everything old was new again. I wondered if Feather Bangs were next in line to make a comeback. I sincerely hoped not. I looked truly horrific with bangs.
So you're back in Cedar River now? Teddy asked. For good?
I nodded. Yuppers, I'm back. Chapter 2. Downtown Cedar River hadn't changed much since I was little. The awnings of the storefronts got new logos every couple of years, and the town council had added a bike lane on Main Street. That was about it. Tonight, cars were parked along the curb as far as I could see as people rotated in and out of our store. It was a welcome twist of fate that we'd managed to open Sip and Spin in the original location of our grandparents' record shop, right between Cedar Spine's bookstore and Boot Scoot and Dance Studio. This coveted storefront, located conveniently in the middle of the block where foot traffic was the thickest, had housed a frozen yogurt shop, a daycare, a shoe store, and most recently a yoga studio. Maggie pointed this out as evidence that the location was cursed, but I think it was just waiting for us to return home. Our new logo, a vinyl record with Sip arching around the top, Spin curved along the bottom, and a giant ampersand in the center, all in bright orange disco-era lettering, was painted on the windows and duplicated again on the lighter orange awning above the entrance. The grand opening banner flapped in the breeze. Our new sidewalk signs were invisible in the mingling crowd. I let out a sigh of contentment. It felt right to do something together as a family. The timing was perfect, during the height of the vinyl revival. The location here in this specific shop, so close to the famed Austin music scene, was ideal. This was gonna work. We would make it work. We had to.
You okay?
Teddy asked, casually draping a comforting arm around my shoulders. He'd misinterpreted my sigh for something else, a conflicted reaction to moving back home, maybe, or just the everyday stress of owning my own small business. Yep, never better. My stomach grumbled again. He laughed at the embarrassingly loud noise. A little hungry, maybe.
There was a taco truck here earlier.
He waved at the recently vacated spot on the curb, which had already been claimed by a shiny new Prius and an ancient, banged-up Dodge pickup truck. If that wasn't a perfect analogy for Texas, at least Austin, I didn't know what was. The old and new, coexisting more or less peacefully side by side.
You should have grabbed some tacos while it was here. They were just the right amount of spicy and fresh, with no boring filler.
Don't rub it in, I said.
Come on.
He turned, paused at the curb to check for traffic, and dashed across the street. I was right on his heels.
The sidewalks downtown normally rolled up by 9 o'clock.
It was approaching 11 now, and while the rest of the block was quiet, the party at the record shop was still going strong. We reached the other side of the street without incident. A car slowed down, did a U-turn in the middle of Main Street, and crept slowly behind us, hoping to snipe our parking spot. I waved the late partygoer on before he could get too disappointed that we weren't leaving and freeing up a space. There was a municipal parking lot at the end of the block, but for some unfathomable reason, everyone preferred to parallel park on the curb. Personally, I'd rather walk the extra block, but maybe that was because I failed the parallel parking portion of the driver's exam 3 times before the haggard DMV employee took pity on me and gave me a license anyway. Is anything still open this late? Instead of answering, Teddy pulled open a door. The smell of hot pizza wafted over us. I felt weak in my knees. There might have been drool. Inside, the air conditioner was blowing full blast, but it couldn't keep pace with the coal pizza ovens behind the counter. I could only imagine what the temperature would be in this place at the height of summer. The woman behind the cash register dabbed her brow with a napkin.
What can I get y'all?
I hadn't realized how much I missed that word until I got back home. When I said y'all in Oregon, people looked at me like I'd grown a third head. It hadn't stopped me from using it. I just got used to the perplexed stares. Here, it was as common as breathing.
3 slices, plain, Teddy ordered.
Even after all the time that had passed since we'd last seen each other, he'd remembered my favorite. Not that it was particularly unique.
Oh, I couldn't possibly eat 3 slices, I protested.
Who said anything about you? This is for me.
I poked him in the ribs with my elbow. It was simultaneously comforting and strange, being back home after so long away. After 6 years of living on my own, I was now staying with my sister, Tansy. My poor Civic would never have made the long drive from Oregon, so I'd sold it before moving back to Texas and relied on my family or my bicycle to get around town. Except, it's not a bicycle. It's an adult tricycle, to be precise. It's long and low, with a giant basket mounted between the back 2 wheels. My trike is perfect to cart groceries home from the farmer's market and is painted a sensational shade of lime green. It's got an ergonomic seat that's 10 times more comfortable than the old Schwinn I used to ride in high school before I got my license, and enough gears to handle most paved roads with ease without being overly complicated. Back in Oregon, I only rode it on the weekends, but now it was my primary mode of transportation. It was a lot to get used to. Everything about moving home at 28 was, to be honest. But at least I got to see my family every day and could reconnect with friends I'd left behind, like Teddy. 3 slices of hot pizza were shoveled onto overlapping paper plates and slid onto a red cafeteria tray that we carried to a table. Teddy dumped a heap of Parmesan cheese and a sprinkle of red pepper flakes on top. He grabbed 1 slice, folded it in half, and took an enormous bite. I snagged one of the other pieces. It tasted as good as it smelled. My eyes rolled back into my head, and Teddy let out a snorting laugh around a mouthful of pizza.
Good, right? He asked.
I nodded, too intent on gulping down my slice without burning the roof of my mouth to respond. He pushed the tray toward me.
You sure?
I asked, then snagged the last piece before he could change his mind. I didn't slow down until even the crispy crust was gone.
Thanks, I needed that.
No kidding.
He stood. His chair made a metallic scraping sound as the legs slid across the tile floor.
But shouldn't you be getting back to the party?
Yuppers. We headed back toward Sip and Spin Records in that companionable silence that only ever existed between old friends. As we drew nearer, I saw that the crowd had thinned out considerably in the short time it had taken us to eat. Then again, it was getting late. People had to drive back to Austin or take the babysitter home before turning in for the night. Thanks again for the pizza.
Anytime.
Teddy waved at someone and they waved back.
I'm gonna call it a night, but I'll see you around.
You know it.
Man, it's good to see you again, Juni,
he said, patting my shoulder before walking away. I watched him for a second before returning my attention to the reason I was here. I wove between the guests, making small talk as I went. I exchanged hugs with acquaintances I hadn't seen in ages, and even a few folks I didn't recognize at all, but who appeared to know exactly who I was.
Where did you disappear to, little lady? My mother asked.
Who, me? I tried to look innocent. As usual, she saw right through me. She gave me a knowing smile.
I saw you sneak off with Teddy Garza. He's a good boy. And single, you know.
Uh-huh, I agreed. Teddy was a good guy. I agreed with that with my whole heart. He was also my friend, and had been as long as I could remember. In school, we were in all the same classes and clubs, and even rode the bus together. He used to pull my pigtails and tease me about my braces. But since I'd been gone, we'd both grown up, and now I was starting to see him in a new light.
You should ask him out. Or you know what? I'll arrange something. There's a dance down at the Civic Center next month. That's the ticket.
Her eyes sparkled with excitement.
Thanks, Ma, but I'm good.
She meant well, and I wasn't opposed to the idea of dating, but if I let her have even the tiniest opportunity, the next thing I knew, she'd be fixing me up with the mailman or some rando passing out hot dog samples at the mall. I pushed my glasses up the bridge of my nose. I see someone over there I need to talk to. I indicated a small clump of people with a jerk of my chin as an excuse to wiggle out of this conversation.
Well then, hurry up, dear. People are leaving.
It was almost midnight before the last guest left. We locked the door behind them. Sometime in the last few minutes of the party, our mother managed to slip away unseen, leaving my sisters and me alone to clean up. That was so like her. Then again, it was our store. Our mess, our responsibility.
That taco truck was a great idea, Juni. What a hit. But I still think we should have asked them to keep the food outside, Maggie said.
She'd already filled one trash bag. An outsider might think she was complaining, but I could hear the unmitigated delight in her voice. Cleaning up after a messy gathering, this was Maggie's happy place.
What's a party without food?
Tansy countered, her voice floating down from the loft where she was haphazardly cleaning upstairs. The open second floor made the shop feel larger than it was and gave us more space to display albums. It more than made up for the floor space we'd sacrificed to create a coffee nook.
And beer, I added, emptying solo cups and stacking them together.
Were solo cups recyclable?
I certainly hoped so.
I took the trash bag from Maggie, tied it up, and carried it down the narrow hallway that led to the dumpsters in the back alley. I opened the back door, and a flash of orange barreled into my legs.
Hello to you too, Daffy, I said as the skittish cat dashed past me.
Daffodil, Daffy for short, was an enormous white and orange tabby cat that looked like a fluffy, novelty-sized candy corn. He'd adopted us when we were first setting up Sip and Spin and decided to make this his home. We'd put up flyers and had him checked over at the vet, but he wasn't chipped and no one came forward to claim him. He didn't like strangers, but had already bonded with my sisters and me. I guess that meant we had a cat now. So I wasn't surprised he'd disappeared during the party. He might eventually adjust to what I hoped would be a steady stream of customers, but I was resigned to him disappearing every time the front door opened. Which might be a good thing if the health inspector ever dropped by to check on the coffee bar. The dumpster was already nearing full. We'd done an awful lot of work getting Sip and Spin records ready for the grand reopening, which resulted in an abundance of construction waste. The garbage company would come by in the morning. In the meantime, I tossed the bag over the lip and it landed with a wet thud. Hopefully, we could finish the cleanup without overflowing the bin. As I let myself inside, Maggie called to me, "Grab a broom, will ya?" "Sure thing." I opened the door in the narrow hallway where we stored cleaning supplies, coffee filters, and other miscellany. I flipped on the light and shrieked. I slammed the door to the supply closet. Maggie looked over at me, one eyebrow lifted. "Is it a mouse? Tell me it's not a mouse. Daffy, Daffy, get in here and take care of this mouse." "It's not a mouse," I said, my voice trembling. My mind was racing, trying to make sense of what I'd seen. "Then what is it?" I took a deep breath. "There's a dead body in our supply closet." "There's not a dead body in our supply closet," Maggie said. She rolled her eyes. "Move, Juni, I need that broom." Being the surprise baby of the family had its advantages. By the time I came along, my sisters were old enough that I never got stuck with their hand-me-downs. It had its drawbacks, too, such as still being treated like an incompetent kid, even though I was in the home stretch of my 20s. I was used to not being taken seriously. "I'm telling you," my sister cut me off and in a shrill, mocking voice said, "Hi, I'm Juniper, and I'm a lying liar. Maggie, I'm serious." I pressed my back against the closed door. "What's taking you two so long?" Tansy asked. She'd come down the stairs and joined us in the cramped hallway. She looked tired. We all were. It had been a long day. "Seriously, I don't know what I'm gonna do with y'all." "There's a dead body in the supply closet," I told her. "Of course there isn't a dead body in the closet," Tansy said. Maggie crossed her arms and smirked at me. "See?" "Fine, you asked for it," I said. Don't get me wrong, Tansy and Maggie were my best friends. They would always be there for me, as I would for them. They brought out the best in me, and the worst. Sometimes at the same time. I turned the doorknob, pushed the door open, and stepped back. My sisters gasped. "There's a dead body in the supply closet," Tansy said. "Told ya." Chapter 3. The three of us stared at the body in the supply closet. There appeared to have been a struggle. The closet was in disarray. There was a pool of blood and a dead woman on the floor. Her long, honey blonde hair covered most of her face. I didn't recognize her. She was white, around 20 or so years old, and wore a white shirt and khaki pants with white tennis shoes, the generic uniform of a service industry job. There was a bright orange canvas tote on the floor beside her. I tried to recall if I'd seen her during the party. I didn't think so, but I'd talked to so many people tonight. "What's she holding?" Maggie asked. I wondered if she realized she was whispering. I shivered and took a step back. I'd already seen quite enough, thank you very much. "There's a piece of paper in her hand," Tansy agreed. "We should take a closer look." None of us moved. "At the very least, someone needs to call the cops," Tansy said. I took another step back. At this rate, I would be in the alley before we came to a consensus. "I'll call JT. He'll know what to do," Maggie said. She married John Taylor Taggart, JT to almost everyone, in college and helped put him through law school. He was now the go-to legal counsel for everyone in town. Most of his work came from civil cases. Despite our proximity to Austin, Cedar River wasn't exactly a hotbed of crime. It certainly wasn't known for having dead bodies in supply closets. "He's not answering." She stared down at her phone. "Was he at the party?" I asked. "I don't remember seeing him tonight." "He had to work late," she replied.
"Lucky for him."
I looked at my sisters. "What are the chances that if we close the door and wish real hard, the, problem will go away?" Tansy shook her head. "Oh, Juni." Always the responsible sister, she walked over to the checkout counter, lifted the shop phone, and dialed 911. Half an hour later, my sisters and I huddled together outside as the police ran yellow crime scene tape around Sip and Spin. Maggie shivered. Tansy took off the outer sweater half of her twin set and wrapped it around our sister. Unlike my Texas-climatized sisters, I was used to the colder weather up north and barely noticed the unseasonable chill in the early spring air. I was perfectly comfortable in my jeans, cowboy boots, and well-worn retro concert t-shirt. Tonight, it was my favorite Nine Inch Nails shirt, advertising an album that had come out before I was born. The tee had originally belonged to my mother. She might not look like it these days in her sensible blouses and linen slacks, but she was quite the rocker back in her day. In front of us, a steady stream of emergency personnel circulated through Sip and Spin Records. EMTs had gone in a while ago, but now they waited outside in the ambulance for the all clear from the crime scene techs. Despite the late hour, the sidewalk behind us was packed with people attracted to the sirens and flashing lights who wanted to get a glimpse of the action. One thing I could say with certainty about small towns was we sure knew how to make our own entertainment. Another thing about small towns was that everyone knew everyone, especially if you'd lived there for generations. It seemed like every person, from the chief of police to the skinny photographer, nodded at us as they passed. Tansy, Maggie, Juniper. In turn, we'd nod and return the greeting. Not even death was an excuse for bad manners, our mother always said. Although when she said that, she'd been talking about goldfish, not a murder scene. Maggie groaned. Automatically, I asked, "What's wrong?" "What isn't wrong? The record shop, our record shop, is an active crime scene." She'd always been the most pessimistic of the three of us, although she preferred to call herself a realist. But I had to admit, in this particular instance, she had a point. "It's gonna be okay," I said, trying my best to reassure her. "What if it's not?" Maggie asked. We stood in silence, letting the ramifications of that sink in. We'd invested an awful lot of money and hard work into the store. Another police car pulled up. There were no spots left at the curb, so the driver simply parked in the middle of the street. It was angled so the ambulance could leave, but no more cars could navigate down Main Street. Which was fine. As far as I could tell, practically everyone in town was already here.
"Ladies,"
the latest arrival said, touching the brim of his police-issued cowboy hat. Contrary to popular belief, not everyone who lived in Texas owned a cowboy hat, but those of us who did never had just one. We had a formal cowboy hat, a casual cowboy hat, a working cowboy hat, and a going-out cowboy hat. Some of us, like the white man standing in front of us now, even had an official uniform cowboy hat. Beauregard Russell, or Detective Beauregard Russell, according to the badge clipped to a chain around his neck, was the one who got away. Or, to be perfectly candid, the one who ripped my vulnerable young heart into itty-bitty pieces and then fed the pieces into an industrial shredder. On either side of me, my sisters tensed, worried I was going to dissolve into a puddle of teenage angst. As if. I'd matured considerably since the last time I'd spent any real time in Cedar River, but I couldn't blame my family for not realizing that, since I was only around for holidays. FaceTime was no substitute for sitting around a dinner table together every night. My sisters had nothing to worry about. I was fine. Honest.
Tansy,
he said. His voice, his specific drawl, sent shivers all the way down to my toes.
Maggie.
The pizza I'd scarfed down with Teddy did cartwheels in my stomach.
And unless my eyes deceive me, Miss Juniper Jessup.
Dark stubble shadowed his face. His big, dark eyes met mine, and I was transported back in time to when I was very young, very naive, and very much in love.
Beau,
I said. My voice came out a lot steadier than I felt. Go me. I knew moving back to Cedar River meant bumping into Beau eventually. Frankly, I was surprised it had taken this long. But nothing had prepared me for running into my ex at a crime scene. A black woman in a uniform opened the door and poked her head outside. She was around my height, with broad shoulders and a no-nonsense expression. She oozed authority, and her voice commanded attention.
Been waiting for you, she said to Beau. What took you so dang long? Hold your horses, Holt,
Beau told her. Then he turned back to us.
Don't y'all go nowhere. I'll be needing to talk to y'all in a bit, he said.
There were three of us there, but I felt like he was speaking to me specifically.
We're not going anywhere, Tansy replied for all of us.
When he was gone, she turned to me.
You okay, baby sis?
Yep, I assured her, nodding confidently. I'd gotten over Beau a long time ago. That was my story, and I was sticking to it.
Never better.
That's our girl, Maggie said, squeezing my hand. An increasingly chilly hour or so later, Beau reemerged with the female officer by his side.
Y'all can go home as soon as you give Officer Holt your contact info. I'll want to talk to each of you tomorrow.
It is tomorrow, Tansy pointed out, tapping the delicate watch on her slender wrist.
Has been for quite some time.
Go on home, he repeated. She drew herself up to full height and put her fists on her hips.
We've got an awful lot of valuable merch inside, and if you think I'm gonna leave our shop unlocked overnight, you're sorely mistaken, Beauregard Russell.
Beau took his cowboy hat off and knocked it against his knee as if to clear off imaginary dust, and flashed a grin at my older sister. His teeth were pearly white and laser straight. Forget the gun in his holster. That ridiculously handsome smile of his was his most dangerous weapon, and he knew it.
Can I talk to Juni for a minute? Alone? He asked.
No. My sisters said in unison, edging forward to form a physical barrier between me and Beau. The only thing more overprotective than an older sister was two overprotective older sisters.
Fine, be that way. Any idea where I might find your uncle, Calvin Voigt?
He rubbed his forehead with the back of his hand before resettling his hat.
At home, in bed, asleep, Maggie suggested. He's not answering his phone.
Why should he? Tansy asked. It's the middle of the night, and what's he got to do with anything anyway?
Need to have a few words with the man. Odd that he's not here.
Tansy glanced down at her watch again. She was one of the few people I knew who still wore a watch that didn't double as a heart monitor, step counter, and social media tracker.
You're surprised that a 60-something-year-old man isn't standing around in his 90 on Main Street at 2 a.m.?
Everyone else is, Beau said, gesturing to the crowd behind us. It had thinned out considerably as people got tired, bored, or cold, and wandered home after making their neighbors swear to call them if anything interesting happened.
Why isn't Calvin?
Tansy shrugged.
You'll have to ask him.
She glanced around at the gathered townspeople. I'm sure I could name a number of others who aren't here either. She turned her attention to us. Maggie, we don't all need to stick around. Mind dropping Juni off on your way home? I'll stay and lock up. Of course she would. Tansy was the responsible one. Maggie was the organized one. I wasn't 100% sure what I was. The tired one tonight. Yeah, that sounds like a plan. I agreed. Beau nodded and returned to the shop. Our shop. Maggie and I started to leave, but Officer Holt stopped us. Ladies, I'm gonna need a few things from you first. Maggie's shoulders slumped. Yeah, sure. Sorry, it's been a long night. I know what you mean, she replied.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.